Welcome back, everybody. We are starting off our first plenary session. Unsurprisingly, it's titled The New Normal. given the excellent opening speech by Dr. John Hamry, who really set the tone and provided the context, we wanted to continue basically in that line. And we have gathered together an incredible lineup of speakers who will help us think these issues through again once more, perhaps in a greater detail, and how it looks from their particular perspective, individually from the perspective of their country, and of course from the region from whence they hail. Let me just quickly introduce all of them first before we engage them in a conversation. To my immediate left is Professor Han Sung-ju. He is the chairman of the International Policy Institute of Korea and also professor emeritus at Korea University. He served as the Minister of Foreign Affairs of the Republic of Korea. He was the UN Secretary General's Special Representative for Cyprus. He was a member of UN Inquiry Commission on the 1994 Rwanda genocide. He was the Korean ambassador to Washington, D.C., and acting president of Korea University. So you can see the wealth and breadth of experience is astonishing. And he was my predecessor as the founding president of the ASEAN Institute for Policy Studies. Next to him is Professor Gil Rosman, who is currently the editor-in-chief of the ASEAN Forum, which is an online, and we've also started the offline version of this journal. And for anyone who's interested, I'm sure many of you have already accessed it, but I think it's now the up-and-coming premier journal on foreign affairs and national security issues, and it's all thanks to Professor Rosman, who has really taken on the task of building this journal for us, and we're very grateful. He has taught, previous to that, he has taught at Princeton University in the sociology department for 40 years, and for me, the most important thing is that he's a graduate of Carleton University, Carleton College, and so my sonbae. And you know how important that is in Korea. So, next to him is Professor Tanaka Akihiko. Professor Tanaka is a professor of international politics at the Institute of Advanced Studies in Asia at the University of Tokyo. All of you know that he's served until last October as the president of the Japan International Cooperation Agency, and of course, all of you know him as one of the foremost experts on international relations in Japan. So welcome, Professor Tanaka. And then finally, we have Major General Zhu Chung-hu, who is a professor at the Academic Department of Strategic Studies at the National Defense University of China. He served as Deputy Director of the Institute for Strategic Studies and Commandant of College of Defense at NDU. So you can see we have gathered together the best minds to help us navigate this very difficult issue. What I've asked them all to do is take each of them take maybe 6-7 minutes to articulate their position, their thoughts on this particular topic, and then afterwards we will either have a debate among ourselves, but I would also like to open it to the floor as quickly as we can. So I'd first like to ask Dr. Han Sung-ju for your first opening comments, please.
Thank you. After the impressive video and very profound speech by John Hamry, I think whatever we say will sound pretty parochial and mundane. But that's the lot we have after following these great presentations. To me, new normal means the situation, phenomenon, or pattern that did not used to be considered normal. before, but it's now considered more or less normal. The new normal in connection with the Korean Peninsula is naturally related to the North Korean nuclear issue. I would like to introduce three episodes or three historical things that I experienced as ambassador in Washington and as Minister of Foreign Affairs in Korea. The first is that this is what happened during the so-called normal times. I attended several summit meetings between President Bush and President Nomuhyun, talking about North Korean nuclear issue. And each time, interestingly, President Bush will say, Mr. President, to President Nomuhyun, I'm sorry, but to us, to the United States, the Iranian issue, Iranian nuclear issue is more important and serious to the United States than the Korean issue. And he said this almost in an apologetic way and without much explanation. He didn't know that actually this was a welcome news to President Nomuhyun, because Nomuhyun was afraid that the United States would react very strongly to the North Korean nuclear problem. The second episode is that, again, in these summit meetings, President Bush would say, whenever he was dealing with his Chinese counterpart, that is, first, the Chinese president Jiang Zemin, and later Hu Jintao, each time the Chinese president would say, well, we don't have too much of an influence over North Korea. President Bush told us that he said to President Jiang Zemin that, well, that's too bad. In that case, we have no choice but to take very extreme action, suggesting that it would mean some military action. And then, presumably, President Jiang Zemin would say, well, in that case, let's see what we can do. And then they took leadership in the six-party talks and other endeavors. And then when they had a new Chinese president, Hu Jintao, the same thing happened. And President Bush reported the same thing when President Hu Jintao said, China doesn't have much of an influence. He said the same thing to Hu Jintao, and then Hu Jintao said, oh, in that case, we'll try to do something. And then China became a little more active in dealing with the issue. The third episode is, and President Bush actually mentions these things in the book that he wrote on his presidency. The third issue is about Chinese and North Korean attitude toward UN sanctions on North Korea. In June of 1994, I went to Beijing, met Foreign Minister Chen Qichen and at that time Vice Minister Tang Jiaxian, and told them that if China did not want to face the situation where China had to either exercise veto or support a sanctions resolution, China has to tell North Korea that North Korea could not count on Chinese veto. And several days later, the Chinese ambassador came to see me and said he got the instruction from his government to tell us that, in fact, that's exactly what Tang Jiaxian told the North Korean ambassador in Beijing, that North Korea could not count on Chinese veto on sanctions resolution. And then a few days later, Pyongyang invited former President Carter to North Korea, which led to the resumption of U.S.-North Korea talks on Geneva talks on the issue. I'm mentioning this because at that time, China could exercise that kind of influence because North Korea was, in fact, very afraid of UN sanctions. And that is the normalcy of the situation. So what is new now that was not considered as normal before? I will make a few, five in fact, observations. Number one, unlike before, meaning when our friend David Sanger was still in Tokyo, North Korea now exaggerates, brags about, and boasts about their nuclear weapons and their capabilities. Unlike before, when they were trying very hard to hide and deny. And North Korea also threatens with nuclear attack on South Korea and the United States as well. Secondly, unlike before, China now more actively supports stronger and harsher Security Council actions on North Korea and even vows to implement them more thoroughly. Three, the idea and possibility of South Korea going nuclear, becoming a nuclear weapon state itself, is more openly and actively discussed, not only in South Korea, but also in other countries, including the United States as well. Number four, the United States is beginning to feel the clear and present danger and threat of North Korea attacking its mainland with nuclear weapons. Whereas, as I said before, the US was more concerned about Iranian nuclear weapons, which was not even in a fledgling state earlier. And finally, there is a palpable resignation regarding the absence of an effective instrument in dealing with North Korean nuclear weapons, short of military attack and or a regime change. So, before, North Korea's nuclear program was considered to be still at a fledgling state, but now it probably possesses dozens of nuclear weapons being manufactured in both plutonium and highly enriched uranium process. The delivery means have advanced, what with short, medium, and long-range ballistic missiles, and even SLBMs. Before, North Korea was afraid of the UN Security Council sanctions resolution, but now, after several such sanctions, North Korea seems unafraid of them and has become quite defiant. Three, before, China, even as it was playing a constructive role in trying to stop North Korean nuclear program, was reluctant to apply explicit pressure on North Korea. Today, China, even as it is not placing all its marbles on the table to persuade North Korea to stop its nuclear program, does play a critical and explicit role in trying to dissuade the DPRK from conducting nuclear tests, without much success though, and to limit its nuclear program. Before, the United States was willing to and did play a leading role in dealing with the issue and negotiate with North Korea. In recent years, it has been reluctant to play that role in the name of strategic patience and has tried to leave the initiative and main burden to other countries, mainly China and South Korea. Now that the U.S. feels the threat of North Korea's direct nuclear attack on the United States. It seems to be more alert and alarmed, but only belatedly, as during the next 1 to 2 years, there isn't much possibility of the U.S. taking a decisive action or policy. Now, North Korea's objective regarding nuclear weapons is regime security. It vows that it is not giving up their nuclear weapons, even if, this is their quotation, even if heaven tumbles down. Why is it not trying, as other late nuclear weapons developers, such as India and Pakistan, had done, to hide, deny, or at least refrain from flaunting their weapons, but is instead boasting, exaggerating, and threatening their use against their enemies? Is the reflection of a strategy or of a misplaced juvenile bravado? We may imagine the following explanations. One, to make North Korea, being a nuclear weapon state, a fait accompli. Two, to raise its bargaining position and to make the price of bargaining higher. Three, to propagandize its and his, Kim Jong-un's, accomplishments. Four, to wage a psychological warfare against South Korea and other states, including the United States, to implant a sense of insecurity and fear and keep them guessing. And finally, to sow doubts among the adversaries and plant uncertainties regarding North Korea's real capabilities and integration. So far, the United States and China paid insufficient attention to the seriousness of the North Korean nuclear problem. China has been more concerned about keeping the North Korean regime afloat than stopping its nuclear program. The United States has been distracted and diverted to other crises, especially the Middle East and the war on terrorism. Only now they seem to be giving such an amount of weight and attention to the North Korean problem that it deserves and demands. China, in fact, has been cooperative in inflicting more pains to North Korea with sanctions than any time before. Let me finally just mention why China seems to be a little more active in this regard. Number one, China is indeed beginning to recognize and feel the threat of North Korean nuclear weapons, both directly and indirectly. Two, Beijing is furious with North Korea for slapping China's hand by conducting nuclear and missiles tests, despite its repeated urgings not to do so. Three, contrary to the earlier thinking that a strong sanctions move in the UN Security Council would weaken or compromise whatever influence China had over North Korea, in fact, strong sanctions would strengthen China's hand vis-a-vis North Korea, as it will have the, it still has the leverage of either strongly implementing it or relaxing it somewhat. So, and for the United States, the question still remains as to whether President Obama and the United States considers North Korean nuclear threat a matter of what Obama calls America's core security interest, or simply an urgent issue, as he made the distinction in his in the Atlantic article on the Obama doctrine. In any case, considering the limited time he has left of his presidency and the U.S. political schedule during the next 12 months, it is unlikely that any new and forceful policy or measure regarding North Korean nuclear weapons will come out of the U.S. government during the next 1 or even 2 years to come. Thank you.
Thank you. Professor Rosman, please.
Well, I consider myself sort of the odd man out. I'm here with distinguished speakers who've represented governments and been involved in the policy process for a very long time. I come from the academic community, and I've just had the terrific opportunity to work from Washington, D.C. with the new journal, the Asan Forum. And it's given me a chance to do two things that I think are helpful in this kind of discussion. One is to make the rounds of Washington think tanks. I think the level of discussion, of analysis, is very high, unparalleled in Washington. If one goes from one session to another on the issues that are coming up here, and it's quite a contrast with the political dialogue in the United States. There really is serious thinking about these issues, but at the same time, there is a sober awareness of problems. And I would say it even leads to a more somber outlook than what I just heard. I think the sense of U.S.-Chinese cooperation on North Korea is less positive right now. There's more worry that that cooperation was only hesitantly developed at a after 2 months of exhaustive effort, and that it's very fragile. And what China is seeking doesn't correspond very well what the United States, South Korea, and Japan are seeking right now. So I don't share that. I guess I come out with even a more negative view of the new normal. At the same time, though, I have a different outlook on the U.S. role. I think there's been a temptation, whether it's in Japan or South Korea, and certainly in other countries that are less cooperative with the United States, to say, you know, Obama's been diverted, the United States hasn't shown leadership on North Korea, and so on. Well, I would say that we've seen in the last few months some real energy from the Obama administration in getting the Japan-Korea deal December 28th. That took years of really intense diplomacy and effort, and I think a lot of credit is owed the administration. Getting China to agree to the UN sanctions was not a matter of any ease. And now the European involvement, where Obama's been very active. So I think these problems actually are more serious than the answer given if only the U.S. was more active in its leadership, if only it had a stronger commitment to this particular issue or that particular issue. I really think we're in a new normal of much more difficult problems that the U.S. leadership is not going to solve very easily, and for the U.S. leadership to work, it requires a different outlook, part of U.S. allies and partners, and a reduction in the illusions that were prevalent only recently in a number of countries, such as South Korea's hopes for China last year, hopes for the Northeast Asia Peace and Cooperation Initiative, the Eurasian Economic Initiative. You got Japan in its effort right now with Abe and in less than 2 weeks going to Sochi and thinking, wow, I can turn Russia away from China, and so on. I just think that is causing a lot of problems for U.S. leadership, the inability to bring the EU together with Japan in thinking about the seriousness of the South China Sea and issues relating to China, or Japan together with the United States and the EU thinking about Russia. So that it seems to me we have a different degree of problems. But I would argue that really the essence of what we're facing in this decade is a turning point that is comparable to the end of the Cold War. When I heard John Hamre's comments, I was thinking of a lot of parallels with 100 years ago. Basically, we are facing a challenge to a common vision, where it's not just national interest. In fact, I would say national interests are less involved. The countries are reinterpreting their national interests to reflect what many would regard as not their real interests. Rather, I think it's become a matter of national identities and retreat in, under the impact of insecurity and globalization to a reconstruction of history, a search for something that could validate your country, a rejection of aspects of globalization. This is what I see happening in the US elections, and I see it as critical to Northeast Asia. So rather than the non-state actors we're so prone to emphasize being the source of the fundamental problem, I would argue in this region, we understand that the real source of the problem is coming from the states. Whether it's North Korea and the failure of 5-1, that is the obvious and long-standing response to North Korean provocations that has been rejected by China and Russia and continues not to be an acceptable alternative to them, although that would suggest a common way of working out the differences in dealing with this far-reaching problem. The failure of ASEAN to be accepted as an arbiter and to be able allowed to manage issues like the South China Sea, so the rejection of regional organizations and the frustration of lots of countries at the return to polarization as the fundamental tendency in our times. And so we see, and I think this may be controversial, but this is what I've taken from the articles I've been reading in the country reports, the other aspect of what I do in the ASEAN Forum, try to immerse myself in the reports coming out of China, of Russia, Japan, South Korea. Do we have a common vision? Are we understanding the problems in ways that are constructive, that make it possible for us to work more closely together? And I see a good deal of progress right now with the strengthening of the G7, the return of the G7, the strengthening of Japan, South Korea, US trilateralism. That's a part, and I think a very important part, of rebuilding the framework that can allow us to move forward. But really, I think we have to try to understand ways of reaching beyond that, building on that foundation, and trying to see if we can get Russia to rethink the notion that we're in a new Cold War, and the elements of the old Cold War are revived, and the revival of ideology as a key element, and using the year 2015 to make history more divisive rather than to make history a source of finding more common ground. And I think this challenge is also very present in China and the way China has interpreted a variety of things and the U.S. loss of trust and Japan's loss of trust and I think South Korea's loss of trust in things that are happening inside China and in China's role in the regional and international system, which could be greatly exacerbated when the ruling comes down from the international court on the South China Sea. So the problems I see right now require a vision that can challenge the changes in national identities that have been so troubling, return to seeing your own civilizations as unique and victimized and humiliated, and requiring drastic solutions in opposition to what would be what we generally understand to be international society and the international order. And I think the U.S. has to do more to help establish that vision under a new leadership, but it also requires a great deal more cooperation from its allies and a shared understanding that so far has been missing.
Thank you, Professor Rosman. Now, Professor Tanaka.
Well, thank you very much. It's a great pleasure to be back at the ASEAN Forum. It's a great privilege for me to share views with such distinguished participants. when I think of the new normal, I think it is influenced by two factors, which I think was alluded by John Hamre quite nicely. One, of course, as John emphasized, is the coming of new kinds of threats empowered by 21st century technology, which appear to be even neo-medieval, emphasizing theocratic aspects represented by ISIS. But in addition to this new threat, we are now observing as a second factor what I might call the return of the symptoms of John Hamre's characteristics of the first half of the 20th century. North Korea appears determined to pursue its own course of having nuclear weapons and missile technologies. It ignored, as Professor Hansen-Ju mentioned, a series of UN Security Council resolutions. That was a sort of activities act that was quite common to what Imperial Japan did after the Manchurian incident, what Nazi Germany did, ignoring the international institutions. Not that, I think, obvious, apparent, but what Russia is doing in Ukraine is really disturbing. What I think the international community has done to Russia was, I think, quite similar to what Henry Stimson did to Japan, non-recognition. How much effective this policy of non-recognition is, remains to be open. Well, not that I think again, obvious, but South China Sea, we are observing unsettling problems. And so we are observing the return of geopolitics. And the 21st century, we need to face the combination of the return of geopolitics as well as the arrival of the new threats represented by a series of terrorist activities. And for that matter, I think East Asia is facing more a geopolitical threat than new threats. But I think we cannot ignore the capability of the transnational terrorists and other organizations. So East Asians, too, have to deal with both of them, I believe. And under these conditions, I think it's quite easy to be very, very pessimistic. But for the sake of, I think, discussion, I would like to point out some of the brighter sides of the first two decades of the 21st century. The well, if we look at East Asia, the last interstate war we had was a Sino-Vietnamese war in 1979. And there had been no interstate wars since then. So we are enjoying more than a quarter century of peace in East Asia. And globally, the 21st century observed very, very small numbers of interstate wars. And even if you count the number of civil wars or ongoing, well, you have Syria. And some, well, quite instability in very many places. But if you count the number of civil wars, and quite serious one, the latter half of the 20th century, which John Hamre regarded as very good period, had more civil wars than the first two decades of 21st century. On other areas of global order, I, you know, in the year 2000, the United Nations agreed what was called the Millennium Development Goals. The first goal was to halve the number of those who are suffering from extreme poverty. And when these goals were agreed, many realists had very, very skeptical view about the workability of such goals. It appeared almost impossible to reduce the number of those suffering from extreme poverty. Then I think regarded as those who are living on less than one US dollar each day. The target year of MDGs was the last year, 2015. And the first goal of halving the people of extreme poverty was achieved actually in 2010. In 1990, more than nearly 2 billion people were living under extreme poverty. Now, less than 1 billion are under extreme poverty. And those suffering from famine also halved over the last two decades. Still having nearly 1 billion people under extreme poverty gives us a sober reflection. But still, this was really the first time in the modern period that we reduced the number of extreme poverty. And last year, although international institutions weren't able to do many things, and we should be very skeptical about their capability, but the United Nations agreed by unanimous vote of what's called the Sustainable Development Goals to be achieved by 2030. And a very ambitious goal was included, actually really to eradicating the extreme poverty down to zero. And then also COP21 has made an agreement for climate change with the participation, thankfully, of the United States and China, the largest CO2 emission countries. And so I think given the new normal, which I feel very gloomy, but I would like to point out that there are opportunities that we can work together. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Tanaka. Please,
thank you. Thanks to Mr. Han for the invitation to be a speaker here at this important function. As far as the new normal concerned, as a Chinese, we are very, very proud of it because it is the invention of Chinese economists with the slowing down of the growth rate of the economy in China. So this is regarded by the economists in China as the new normal. So as far as the security in the world concerned, I think there are a lot of new phenomena. For example, the conflicts. Of course, we witnessed conflicts everywhere in the world in the history, but now we have found new sorts of conflicts. Second is terrorist attacks. Terrorist attacks were limited in some of the areas, but nowadays it could be found everywhere in the world, including East Asia, especially China. It used to be a land which was almost free of the nuclear terrorist attacks. But now you can see it in not only in China, but also in Europe, which rarely are attacked by the terrorists. Now it's different. Third is the choice which could be found everywhere, not only in Asia, but also in different parts of the world. Fourth is the anarchist, and the fifth is the financial crisis. We experienced the financial crisis of 2008, and the European countries are experiencing very severe crisis, debt crisis. And I think East Asia may experience a new crisis in the near future. Sixth is the rivalry between the major powers, which has never been witnessed following the end of the Cold War. There is the rivalry not only between China and the United States, but also between China and Japan. And there is the rivalry between Russia on one hand, and the other major powers like the United States, Japan, and the European countries on the other. So these are new phenomena. And rising tension over the disputes and the maritime interests, which could be found in South China Sea and also East China Sea between China and Japan. Of course, we also find it in somewhere else, like in the Caucasus area, which happens between different countries. Eighth is the low growth rate. Asia used to be the locomotive or engine of the world economy, but now it is entering into a new period of slowing growth rate, low growth rate. Ninth is the arms race. Arms race disappeared for a pretty long time following the end of the Cold War, but nowadays it is there between different countries, between China and the United States, between China and Japan, and even between some of the countries among the ASEAN members, and of course between Korea and Peninsula. Tenth phenomena is the proliferation of weapons of mass destruction. A lot of words have been devoted to the nuclear issue in DPRK. I think the nuclear status of North Korea, if accepted by the world community, it will lead to further proliferation of weapons of nuclear weapons and other weapons of mass destruction. So we need to work together to check the further development of the nuclear program of DPRK. I think it needs the collective efforts to address it. 11th is the difficulty in the establishment of effective mechanisms or institutions for addressing this sort of a security dilemma or security new normals. To be very frank, in East Asia, especially in Asia Pacific, we are not short of institutions, but we are short of effective institutions. You can look at the institutions we have established. I don't know which is very effective. Maybe some of the guys present here believe that the military alliances might be effective, but it's effective to some countries, but not universally. So this is a problem. Lastly, I think here, it's not a new normal, but it's the old normal, that is the splitting status of the states, especially Korean Peninsula and China. This may lead to the exchanges of fires between the major powers. I think this is the one of the root causes for the insecurity and unsafety in East Asia. So I believe this is the most important one, but it's, even though it's not new. In my understanding, in the foreseeable future, the new normal will pose serious challenges to the world community because of the different approaches between the major powers to the settlement of the new normals. So Western powers tend to address this issue by strengthening the military alliances, which have been existing for so many years, even though they are the products of Cold War. The facts prove that these sort of new military alliances were not successful. I cannot say it's a failure in addressing a lot of issues like the Iraq issue, like the Afghanistan issue, like those countries in the Northern Africa. If you look at this, I think the military alliances played instead of a constructive role, but might be destructive role. So this is the approach. Maybe some countries tend to address the new normal with, by strengthening the military alliances. But I believe that the other approach to the settlement of the disputes or the issues, the new normals, is to carry out cooperation, sincere cooperation. This is a practical cooperation. This is a must. Without cooperation between the major powers, I don't think these new normals could be addressed easily. Therefore, the major powers, especially the United States and China, will have to build up at least the fundamental trust, which is the basis for practical and effective cooperation between China and the United States in addressing this sort of new normal. Thank you.
Thank you. I'd like to ask each of you just one very short, very difficult question, and then we'll open it up to the floor. Professor Han, I mean, I think before we started the session, we sort of agreed that we won't paint a rosy picture just yet, since this is still the opening session. We still want to stay with the gloom and doom part, but still, I mean, this isn't exactly what I expected, except for Professor Tanaka, who gave us a sliver of hope. Everybody painted a completely, overwhelmingly dark picture. So, Professor Han, I think for you, when you look at, well, not just you, but we completely agree with your analysis of the new normal, especially when it comes to North Korean issue, but it seems like every single point you made about the new normal is basically, we completely failed. It's been an abject failure. Do you see any silver lining in new normal that over the past 20 years compared to what we had faced much earlier when sanctions were well, North Koreans seemed to be a little more afraid of it, etc. What do you think is the way out? Can you think of point to one bright spot?
The question is sort of two-sided or two-fold. If there is any silver lining, I think there is an increased consciousness about the seriousness of the issue. Regrettably, not so much in South Korea itself as in China and the United States. Mm-hmm. And I think there is room, since there is a great deal of concern and continuing attention given to the North Korean issue.
So you're saying US and China is actually more concerned with the issue than South Korea?
No, I'm saying that the degree of concern has increased more in those two countries.
That's
right. And I think there is a growing possibility of cooperation and coordination among the among the six-party countries besides North Korea. China, for some reason, does feel that North Korean nuclear weapons and capability are both a direct and indirect threat to the security of the of China itself. And now the United States is feeling the pinch itself. And that is a sort of silver lining, so to speak. Mm-hmm. I think the
United States has also begun to feel the possibility of direct threats. The U.S. was mainly concerned about the transfer possibility of North Korean nuclear material and technology. But now it seems to have advanced in its ability to attack the United States, not only U.S. bases, but also the American territories itself. And that is going to be a great concern. And, there's more room for sustained pressure on North Korea mm-hmm. to do something about it. In an ironic way, for North Korea, probably North Korea feels that with the fifth test that is likely to come soon, the technological need to continue with the tests would not disappear but abate to a certain extent, and therefore they might want to engage in some kind of a moratorium or a deal with the outside world, which can start for further negotiation. But that is still a long shot prospect. Now you talk about the solution, that I don't have any silver bullet, the bullet that I can think of. I did mention, for some reason, intentional or unintentional, the possibility of the use of the force and the possibility of the system in North Korea, the regime or whatever, changing, and which might in fact result in a more fundamental solution of the problem, and whether we can actually plan and create that kind of situation, I don't know, but I wouldn't rule out that possibility either.
Thank you. Professor Rosman, I agree that I think what you call the rise of identity politics is crux of the matter, and you also said that that there was this challenge to a common vision. Can you elaborate a little bit more? What was the common vision that's being challenged? And second part of it is the question is, you said that you can't simply people can't simply ask for the United States to do more. What is it that the U.S. can and should do without, you know, being asked to do what it used to do?
I think the many thought there was a common vision in the 1990s, mm-hmm. and it came out of the Cold War. It was actually building in the Cold War among U.S. partners and allies, with a sense that China was buying into a significant part of it. This was to strengthen international institutions. We could have a shared international system, and it would be applicable in East Asia through responding to North Korea as the outlier challenging our common sense of order. Mm-hmm. Countries believed in the need for security and peace for prosperity. It would be applicable in the South China Sea by having a code of conduct and relying heavily on ASEAN. We would defer to ASEAN mm-hmm. and strengthen it as an institution. So I see the U.S. today is trying to reemphasize this vision and seeking a more shared outlook between Japan and Korea rather than emphasizing their own historical civilizational differences, and seeking a more shared sense of an ASEAN community, and then reaching out to China and Russia and saying, we have lots of common interests, let's build on them. When I hear a remark like the general just made, that the major problem in East Asia is the alliance system, and that has caused the troubles, and I see many Chinese and Russian articles that say the crux of the North Korea problem is the U.S. and its allies' approach to North Korea, and if only that approach changed, we would somehow get denuclearization and we go on a different process. That we haven't a common vision on North Korea. We really don't agree on priorities and steps, and the differences have become more serious, and as the certain countries become more alarmed, particularly South Korea, the possibility of working with China with this emphasis is growing much dimmer. So what can the U.S. do under these circumstances? I think the two-sided approach is still essential, but becoming more urgent to strengthen the alliance partnerships. To say, as long as the opposition, the other side is saying the alliances are the problem and not willing to accept THAAD and not willing to accept the purposes of the alliance and trying to resist North Korea and establish freedom of navigation, then the urgent first task is to create a more shared global alliance system.
Thank you. Professor Tanaka, I think you represent the old normal of Japan, and this is good. Is speaking of this common vision, that the old common vision that Professor Rosman just outlined, is there a sense that Japan is veering from that common vision because of all these other issues that have come up? We sort of try to fashion in the video as, you know, is the postmodern Japan, the Japan that I like, that I think you represent, but is that Japan going to reverting to a modern Japan, a greater sense of national identity, as Professor Rosman said? Is that too alarmist?
I rate the likelihood of Japan becoming pre-modern very, very low. I continue to believe Japan continues to be one of the most post-modern countries in the world. I think there are, you know, a lot of different evaluations of Prime Minister Abe's statement commemorating the 70th anniversary of the end of the Second World War. But I think the statement represents far clearer understanding of or representing a consensual view of Japan than the Murayama statement. The Murayama statement, in my understanding, has been very unclear about the reasons why Japan made wrong decisions. And Abe's statement last year pinpointed the fact that Japan made wrong decisions because it ignored the international institutions and international norms then prevalent. And on that, I believe very few people, questioned. And so I think that was a quite good movement toward a positive role that Japan is going to play. But then, given the North Korean situations, it is necessary, I think, for Japan to increase more activity to strengthen the alliance with the United States. Mm-hmm. And I think some of the changes made by Japanese parliament with respect to legislation concerning SDF's activities and its activities in concert with the American military, I think are necessary. And these changes, in my understanding, do not represent Japan's return to pre-war types of irrational militarism. It represents an attempt in line with the desirable international institutions.
Thank you, Professor Tanaka. General Chu, I think when we hear about, I think your list, I think you had about 11, and your analysis of the current ails, you know, what ails the global community, I think we completely agree. I can't think of a single issue where we now. I think it's where, of course, obviously it's a prescription part, how we try to overcome these issues. That's where we may differ. One of the things that I heard from you today, but also I think Professor Rosman also highlighted this, is that this issue of how many of the issues will be solved if only the United States and China, the two big powers, can see eye to eye to come to some kind of accommodation. For a Korean, that is a very disturbing, that is an incredibly disturbing thing to say. I think if you guys say it just amongst the two of you very secretly, you know, we sort of expect that of the big powers. And, you know, we always talk about, amongst Koreans, we say that, okay, you know, we're squeezed between these two big powers, you know, if we go this way. So this constant balancing act. But then it's different when it actually comes from one of the two big guys. More concretely, when we try to, for instance, discuss the issue of North Korea, if somehow the North Korean nuclear issue and how we go about solving it, if that discussion then somehow is metamorphized into, you know, if only the US and China can do something, that is very disturbing, because we would like to focus on North Korea as it is, the proliferation issue as it is, which you clearly recognize, and I was very happy to hear that you said that, look, we can't recognize North Korea as a nuclear anything because that would lead to proliferation. So if we can just, you know, somehow focusing on that but then saying that it's an issue ultimately between US and China, yeah. Comfort me.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. I think the resolution of the nuclear issue in North Korea lies solely on talks, negotiations. I don't think sanctions will lead to the final resolution of the nuclear issue, because we are not shut off of sanctions in the past. We have put so many sanctions on DPRK. Here we have so many South Korean friends. You know, the Orientals are different from the Westerners. So the more difficulty they have, more united they might be. This is the true reality in the eastern part of the world. So I think the Chinese have advocated that we should continue the negotiation. But to be frank, some of the parties which are pretty much concerned about the nuclear issue in DPRK are not very interested in that. There is one fact which is very clear. The longer you delay the negotiation, the more mature, more perfect, and the more greater nuclear arsenal the North Koreans will have. Only by bringing the DPRK on the negotiation table can we try our efforts to persuade them not to do that, not to do this. Otherwise, it's very, very difficult. So I think this is one important reason. Secondly, if you look at China's policy, which is a little bit different from other actors in the region, China is facing a lot of challenges on nuclear issue in DPRK. But China advocates to list the stability on the first priority, which is quite different from DPRK, from ROK and from the United States and from Japan. Why? Because we are a stakeholder. To be very frank, if anything happens, crisis happens in DPRK or between DPRK and ROK, I think ROK and China will be the biggest victims. United States can launch attack and decapitulation, etc. But what will be the result? How about how we Chinese and the Koreans manage the flow of refugees? How can we prevent the terrorist attacks? Can we prevent DPRK to use those weapons like chemical or biological? It's very difficult. It can never deliver it to the continent of North America, but it's pretty easy to do it against China and the ROK. Therefore, we Chinese have got different approach. Another one is that the China is different from the United States on the denuclearization. We strongly advocate the denuclearization of DPRK. But how about the nuclear weapons of the United States? This is another issue. So if you look at the goals, objectives of two sides, United States and DPRK, they're different. So we have to take into consideration the security concerns of DPRK and how to protect, how to provide the security guarantee to DPRK. This is a very important issue because it is the greatest security concern of the United States, of the DPRK. If we ask the DPRK to denuclearize itself, what can you provide to DPRK to protect itself? This is a serious problem we are facing. So in my personal understanding, we have to start the talks and the negotiations as soon as possible. Either is try a six party or four party or two parties, two bilateral talks. Six party is there, four party maybe United States, ROK, China, and DPRK. And of course, two parties, it might be United States and DPRK, ROK and the DPRK, etc. So I believe talks are most and only way to the resolution of the nuclear issue in DPRK.
Thank you. I'd like to now open up to the floor. If you have a question, please raise your hand. We have microphones everywhere, and if you get it, please identify yourself very quickly and ask the question very quickly. Anybody? Yes.
My name is Philip Stevens from the Financial Times. I wanted, first of all, to push back a little bit against Professor Zhu on the question of sanctions. You said that we've tried all these sanctions against DPRK and they haven't worked. My understanding from talking to people both in China, also at the United Nations and the US, is that the sanctions applied to DPRK have been much, much weaker than those applied, for example, to Iran. The financial sanctions in particular, where third-party banking was more or less closed down to Iran, has not applied to DPRK. And that's, I think, by agreement between the US and China. So I think it's a mistake to say that we have tried sanctions and they've failed. My second point is that I think everyone believes in negotiations. Everyone thinks that, you know, diplomacy is about talking to your adversaries, not to your friends. So no one can disagree. But I think if you're going to start negotiations, you have to have some concept of where the solution lies. And you made the point, I think, that in return for denuclearization, DPRK would need guarantees, security guarantees. And I think everyone understands that the DPRK, above all, is afraid of regime change. So if the security guarantees are the answer, what sort of security guarantees should the United States, should the Republic of Korea and others in the region be offering? And if you like, in return for which they could reasonably demand the denuclearization, the DPRK.
Thank you. Professor Zhu, I'm going to take a few questions to give you some time to think about this very long and difficult question. But we have another question over there, please.
Thanks so much. Chris Nelson, Nelson Report. I have the honor of chairing the final panel tomorrow on precisely this question. So I'm hoping that our Chinese friends can supply the answer to what is it that you base your faith on the idea that denuclearization is still negotiable? I mean, everything that I've heard and read and seen from Kim Jong-un and his regime is that it is simply out of the question now. The only question for them is we accept them as a nuclear power, and then we can proceed to negotiate a peace treaty of some kind, which is not acceptable to us, and I don't think has been acceptable to you or to others. So I'm confused by the current Chinese apparent feeling that denuclearization is still, in fact, negotiable, when we see no evidence of that and no interest in that from, and that, of course, that's the nut of the question. So perhaps you could explain to us why it is that for China, denuclearization is still a viable negotiating option. Thank you.
Any other questions? Anybody else? Yes, way in the back.
Thank you. Alan Lefkowitz from Bar-Ilan University. Quick question for Professor Tanaka. Do you think that Shinzo Abe's new defense policy will change or will continue after his after the election?
Okay. Any other questions? Anybody else?
Yes.
Since General Chu will answer all these questions, I might just add one more. In East Asia today, particularly after the end of the war in Vietnam, we're enjoying a relative peace. Now, the problem we are facing today with the North Korean nuclear project is the following. East Asian countries, including Japan and Australia, and ASEAN countries, accept China as the only nuclear power in East Asia. That's all right with us. But if we allow North Korea to become a nuclear entity as she hopes to, then what you're really saying is that we will have two nuclear countries in East Asia. That's all right with China? That's something we cannot imagine that China would tolerate. But what North Korea aspires to seems to be to have two nuclear power in East Asia, namely China and North Korea. I don't think that's acceptable to many of us, certainly including Japan. So while we understand the Chinese hope to bring a peace through a negotiation, and we are certainly open to negotiation, we have to make it clear that ultimately we cannot accept more than one nuclear power in East Asia, namely China. In other words, we cannot allow, the international system could not allow North Korea to join P5 as one more additional legitimate nuclear power.
Thank you.
I would like to hear your views on this.
Okay. Here.
TJ Pampel from UC Berkeley. As a firm believer in the importance of domestic politics in shaping foreign policy, I feel I have to ask how the four panelists would respond to the possible implications of the US presidential election on whether the new normal would get better or worse, and whether the foreign policies that you might envision coming out of the US are likely to be radically changed or continued as a result of this election.
Thank you. One more question in the back. Ambassador Yun.
My name is Im Song-jun, formerly worked for the Korean government. Well, I worked a lot on the North Korean file, including the resolution of North Korean nuclear issue, and I worked for Dr. Han when he was foreign minister of my country. And there were two deals, I mean, you know, between the North Korea and the rest of the world. The first one was a bilateral one between the United States and North Korea. And you know, in 1994, the agreed form was concluded between the two parties. And the agreement, I mean, you know, maintained for about 8 years from 1994 until 2002. When North Korea was found, I mean, to you know, produce HEU, well, so the deal collapsed, and then after that, I mean, the Sixth Party began, and there were some agreements, but it was not implemented, and you know. Virtually, the six-party talks again collapsed in 2009. For the last time in 7 years, we didn't see any meeting or any negotiation. Well, now, I mean, the international community is united to impose a sanction on North Korean, you know, continuous provocations. But, well, I met a Canadian scholar, professor, who recently began traveled to Pyongyang, and well, the scholar had some implications from very high ranking official of North Korea. North Korea is now very busy to prepare for the, I think, party congress in May, June, but after that, they may come to the negotiation table with what form, I don't know. Well, I'd like to put a question to Dr. Han. In my view, I mean, the six-party talks is unlikely to resume anytime soon. But when, well, you know, there was a good question, you know, put by Mr. Nelson. Well, you know, whether the negotiation is really possible under the circumstances now. But my question is to Dr. Han, whether if the negotiation, you know, begins sometime, maybe later, North Korea always, I mean, you know, put some importance, I mean, to the format or visual, well, two-party talks or, you know, four-party talks, six-party talks, rather than substance of the negotiations. So what do you think, you know, is the best format, I mean, if negotiations begin sometime later? Thank you.
Thank you. And we have actually one last question in the, one last question, Colonel Lowe.
Thank you, Chair. My name is Ouyang, National Defense University of China. Thank you, the four the panelists. My question to the four panelists, that according to the Russian role in the Middle East, is it possible the Russian playing the maybe a more active role in the Korean Peninsula? I think in Northeast Asia. Because the North Korean officers now visit the Russian, engaging with the Russian. How do you evaluate, how do you assessment, give assessment? Yeah, it is impossible that Russian can play a significant role in Northeast Asia. Thank you.
Thank you. So we have to close the question. So what I'd like to do is actually starting with General Zhu. You can answer all the questions in 2 minutes. And then I will ask all the panelists, then we'll go in the reverse order, and we'll give you 2 minutes each in the remaining 4 minutes. I don't know how that's possible, but I'll try to do
yes,
that.
Yes, I'll try.
So please, let's start with you.
So first of all, about sanctions. China is very serious in putting sanctions on the on DPRK this time. But I have to say that we will have to take into consideration of the humanitarian needs. So recently, we have rejected several ships from DPRK, which are transporting resources to China. So this is one of the important factors. Secondly, about the talks, I think only by sitting together and talking can we know what they require. So this is very important. I think this is the precondition for the settlement of the issue in DPRK. I don't know what DPRK once, but recently they said that they proposed that we stop the nuclear test, you stop the military exercise, join the military exercises by DPRK and by AOK and the United States. But I don't think this is acceptable to you, but you can put forward your requests to DPRK in the negotiation. I think this is very important. About denuclearization, to be very frank, I don't think it's easy to denuclearize North Korea because they have spent so much, and they are heavily dependent on the protection of national security with nuclear weapons, so it's very difficult. But I think the world community, the United States in particular, will have to be practical. I'm wondering if we can practice those suggestions by Professor Hager, etc., like no further development and no test, no weaponization, no proliferation of weapons and those nuclear technologies and the materials. And 1 year is to protect the security guarantee to them. What kind of security guarantee? I think this needs to be discussed. So we need this discussion. About the problem of the nuclear status, I think nobody should accept it. As you know, when Mr. I don't know what's the name in pronunciation, he went to China and met with President Xi Jinping and asked for aid. President Xi Jinping said, you have to denuclearize yourself, otherwise we cannot provide any assistance or aid to you. So this is quite clear. I think this is very, very, very important. I think if the status of nuclear status of DPRK is accepted, more countries will have nuclear weapons. AOK, Japan, and even other countries. Of course, I think it might be a foregone conclusion in the future, but we will try to postpone this process as far as possible. This is another one. The impact on China, U.S. U.S. election. I think Chinese are pretty much concerned about who is going to be the president of the United States. This is pretty much concerned about China's interest. It's also pretty much concerned about the security situation in this region because most of the Chinese believe that the present security problems in East Asia most of them have been brought about by the Obama's assistants, especially Hillary. So we are pretty much concerned. So maybe Chinese would prefer to have Trump to be the president. So he is believed to be a socialist in that case. So it's a different. Of course, that's my personal understanding. About the rule of Russia, I think the rule of Russia in East Asia, especially in Northeast Asia, should be encouraged. And I think Russia is trying to restore the historical relationship with DPRK, even though it is against the nuclearization of DPRK. Thank you.
Thank you. Professor Tanaka.
Well, thank you. Is Mr. Abe going to change his policy stance after the third election? Is that the question, I think? Well, that's highly unlikely. Because it is again highly unlikely for the LDP to win a big victory in the coming House of Councillors elections. I gather that it will maintain the majority, but it's nearly impossible to get the two-thirds majority in the upper house. So that means the political domestic conditions do not change very much. Being a realist politician, Mr. Abe will not change, particularly its international stance. I believe in the prevailing of wisdom in the American presidential election. No matter who becomes American president, US political system with its very complex checks and balances will, in the end, produce good policy.
Spoken like a true diplomat, Maki. Professor Rosman.
We've become so obsessed with Donald Trump that we keep thinking of the next period of foreign policy as if he is the U.S. president. The odds right now, of course, there's a lot of surprises over the last year, are that Hillary Clinton will be the next president. And the odds are that, given her experience, she'll be the most experienced foreign policy president that we've had in modern times. And she will, despite her waffling on TPP and the need to figure out how to reestablish a more globalized orientation after months of battling with the more isolationist Bernie Sanders, she will provide a lot of continuity and a stronger sense that foreign policy is at the center of U.S. foreign policy. So I think that's what people should mainly be focusing on, despite the discussion that we all become absorbed with. As far as Russia, yes, it's restoring traditional ties to North Korea, but when one looks at Russian sources, as we've done very intensively in the ASEAN Forum, paying a lot of attention to the Russian turn to the east and efforts to change its relationship with various countries in East Asia, especially North Korea, I think we should be concerned, because some of the points we've heard now about the purpose of negotiations to reassure North Korea about security at a time when the U.S. alliance system is the danger, is a threat to much of the security, are very strongly presented in Russia, which and many of the commentaries from Russia suggest that that really it's Cold War thinking that's interfering with the deal on North Korea. So even though Russia has gone along with the sanctions in early March, despite delaying them for a few days and getting an exception, I think this is a matter of considerable concern. And right now, every indication is that Russia doesn't really have another option in this region except trying to get some independent voice on North Korea and strengthening its ties with China, and not really having a likelihood of an important change by its negotiations with Japan or its claims for India or its continued talk about something special with Vietnam. Really, the polarization that Russia has welcomed is likely to spread to this region as well.
Thank you. Professor Han.
Yeah, I'll try to respond very briefly to two questions. The first one is by Ambassador Im on six-party talks. Right now, it's not being held, and there are certain conditions by both the United States and the Republic of Korea in holding meetings of that kind. But there is certainly a usefulness of six-party talks if and when the conditions are met.
And that is it, in addition to the negotiation and consultation among the six parties, it allows two-party, three-party, other mini-multilateral meetings, and which sometimes in the past resulted in useful results, consequences. And also, while the meeting is being held, it tends to reduce the tension and tends to restrain provocations by a party, particularly North Korea. So I do hope that at some point the meeting would be held. On the question of the U.S. presidential elections, actually, it's the question I would ask our American colleagues rather than myself answering. But my feeling is that whoever is elected, somehow there will be a semblance of a new paradigm in U.S. foreign policy, especially regarding East Asia and the Korean Peninsula emerging. And that relates to how much of a core interest North Korea and its nuclear problem is, whether to emphasize pressure, engagement, or even force, whether the U.S. Pivot to Asia, whether you call it rebalancing or not, especially away from the Middle East, how much and what kind of nuclear umbrella the U.S. will and should provide its allies, such as Japan and South Korea. At the moment, the only known quantity is the candidate Hillary Clinton, but I think even she has certain differences from the current framework of U.S. policy, and I would expect again whoever comes out as the winner, there will be a move to formulate a new policy, maybe not radically different, but certainly not the same.
Well, thank you. I think we've definitely succeeded in deepening the doom and gloom. I think we have really put the spotlight on the difficulties that we really face in this age of the new normal. And we've provided enough intellectual fodder for it to last us at least another 2 days, right? So please join me in thanking my panelists, and this panel is adjourned.